Welcome back, Monday Night Lights 101.7 WDSR. Alongside Lewis Schaefer, as always, I am Tim Hoffmeister. We are ready for a very, very good show.
Oh, yes.
There'll be some very interesting things said tonight about definitely the Eagles, and we'll obviously talk some MLB offseason. We'll talk about some of the possibilities going on, what teams are making what moves here and there, and then, of course, we'll talk the college football playoff. I did make a case for Penn State throughout the past 2 weeks, or the Big Ten champion. It ended up being Penn State.
Yeah.
Lewis, obviously, showing love for Ohio State, and
I am genuinely upset that we don't have Browns class tomorrow. I had Ohio State hoodie ready.
I went by her office today and gave a we are, just because, I mean.
that was amazing.
Yeah, I mean, it was a really good game,
yeah.
And I was surprised at a lot of things I was surprised about with the college football playoff.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, I kind of expected Ohio State to make it, but at 3, not so much. But we'll get to that. We'll probably shoot for the beginning of the 8 o'clock hour or in our second segment, depending on how the show goes. But first, I want to touch on some Eagles, and we'll touch on the Giants as their winning streak was snapped.
Yes.
Oh, was that like a six?
Six games.
Six mm-hmm. game. All right. That's I think right about what the Flyers have right now, six-game winning streak. But first, with the Eagles, two back-to-back terrible weeks. We'll get Birch calling in, I'm certain. He'll have a lot to say about it. That's why we're going to try and get him in the call at 7:20 so we don't. I don't want to get him too crazy. Like, if you keep him on air for too long, then he'll really start.
And it goes back to Alshon Jeffrey,
yeah,
and T.O.
We'll throw out some real crazy stuff. So if we get him on there for 10 minutes, he'll have a lot of interesting things to say. And I think maybe some valid points. I mean,
I know one thing. He'll finally support what you've been saying all season.
Oh, I mean, yeah, I've never been on the Doug bandwagon. I was looking at a couple stats as I'm. Let me pull them up right now. Just like offensive stats. I was just bored one day. I wasn't going to tweet them or anything. And then I found out, oh, crap, like Cleveland, who has gone through three quarterbacks, have a terrible offensive line.
Tell me they have a better offense than the Eagles.
In a lot of stats, they do.
Oh, my God.
And
oh, my God.
And I didn't check. I checked before right after the Green Bay game, I think. And it's probably not better this time.
Well, yeah, because now they had their bye week. They didn't have their bye week yet at that point.
So I believe this is, I think it's probably updated. But you look at total offense. All right, Phillies ahead of Cleveland. I mean, only by less than 300 yards. But still, we'll take it. Let's see. This is the one that I think is interesting, if I'm not mistaken. Where are they at? We're only 54 yards ahead of Cleveland in passing yards per game.
Oh,
however,
God.
We're supposed to have a franchise quarterback.
And they have Josh McCown.
And
they probably have the lead if they have RG3.
Or Cody Kessler for the whole season.
Yeah.
I mean, he at times he's looked good in the offense. Let's see. I'm trying to find the stats that I had. I know this is looking bad right now, but...
I mean, regardless, it's going to look bad. It's you guys,
I mean,
in Cleveland.
Basically, we're close to Cleveland and everything. For some reason, I don't know what happened over the past two games, but we passed them on a couple. I didn't check before the game.
Well, probably just the bye week coming into factor.
True.
They didn't have their bye week until last week.
That's true. So, but we are close to them on almost every stat, and I looked at it only because I wanted Hugh Jackson a lot. And basically, they don't have a win. We get that. Their defense is terrible. Their offense is not good. But they're actually able to almost have the same or better offense as the Eagles. with three different quarterbacks, a terrible offensive line, a quarterback playing wide receiver, their first-round wide receiver not being healthy at all this year.
Their playmaker being suspended again.
I mean, they have a 32-year-old tight end that had a good year last year, but before that, he was nothing. They have probably the best tackle in the league, who's hasn't missed a down in his entire career. I wish we could have that, one that didn't go off or false start almost every play or wasn't suspended for 10 games. They have a running back in Crowell. I mean, I think he's averaging like 3.2 yards a carry, but for some reason, their offense is still moving and scoring points and really, really close to us in most stats. And if I were, as an Eagles fan, that is alarming. And as a Hugh Jackson fan, I mean, I have nothing else just to say, like...
Told you so.
Yeah, and that doesn't do anything for me other than make me... Like, I wish I was wrong. Like, people are like, oh, like, you're just trying to show that you're right. Like, no, like, it sucks being right now because the Eagles have degressed since the first 3 weeks. And it's been terrible. And the Cowboys have one loss. And I don't like that. And the Giants are actually good this year, and I don't like that. The Redskins still suck. That's fine. I'm used to it at this point. I mean, I wasn't an Eagles fan in the 80s, obviously, because I wasn't born. But for Eagles fans in the 80s, I know they have more Redskins hate than I do.
Yeah.
Or that even you do, Lewis, because, I mean, I don't even remember the last time they were. I mean, they had that one RG3 year.
They had the RG3 year.
And they had James Thrash.
Yeah. And, like, Jason Campbell.
Yeah. So, I mean... But, I mean, you got to look at how is this, like, adjustments are being made throughout the year. I get that.
Yeah.
Where are the adjustments for us?
Yeah.
And it looked like the team quit on the coaching staff. And it was a big deal last year when it happened to Chip and Lori fired him. Because, one, Lori doesn't like to get embarrassed. And he's not going to have a coach around that the players quit on him. I get that. I was okay with the Chip firing.
Eventually.
I mean, I still liked him as a coach, his GM. As a GM, not that great. But, I mean, this year you're also getting embarrassed. And looks like players have quit on Doug. Doug in his press conference today said that he said that not everyone out there gave 100%. And if you're getting embarrassed and people are quitting on you, and Doug wasn't even the top pick.
Yeah.
Or the second pick, from what I understand. I read a lot from this, from Elliot Short Parks. He's the top Eagles beat writer.
Mm-hmm.
He gets a lot of information. He writes for NJ.com. He said it probably wasn't even their second choice. So why wouldn't you have...
I believe that he might not even have been the third.
I mean, I could say it. I mean, and that's why I raised the question, like, who was the first two guys on the list?
Yeah.
I think this may be a one-and-done year. This may be, I mean, it's, I don't know if I would be against it. I don't know if I would be for it. I definitely know that this team needs to pick it up in the last four games.
Yes.
To actually save his job. But and then at the same time, though, will they?
Yeah.
And that's the question. Well, I mean, as a unbiased, I mean, not biased because, not unbiased because you're a Giants fan, but seeing that the Eagles aren't doing well, it makes it a little easier to watch them. I know that from personal experience. What do you see?
I mean, I totally agree with you. The offense, you know, Wentz is playing... Like, I expected him to all season. You know, he had those first three games where he was on fire, and then, you know, it slowly started to taper off. This is what I thought he would be all season. I didn't expect anything big from him year one, given the circumstances, given that he was not the most highly touted prospect, you know, coming out of FCS, you know, he was taken number two. Just because, you know, who else are you going to take? I mean, in hindsight, yeah, you could say Dak Prescott. But at the time, who else are you going to take? Christian Hackenberg? You know, Paxton Lynch? So this is how I saw it playing out all season. It just hadn't yet. And I kind of feel like it's almost time to try a different approach. You had Andy, who was a big-time offensive guy, you know, big with the West Coast offense, and then you bring in Chip, who's supposed to be this offensive guru coming out of Oregon. He fails. Then you bring in Andy's OC, another offensive guy. Part of me thinks it may be time for a philosophy change at head coach and go maybe with a defensive guy this time around. I think if you can look at Jameis Winston, for example. They had Smith last year, defensive guy, you know, built that defense into what it is and is going to become. And then they fire him for God knows what reason and bring in Dirk Koetter, probably just to keep Dirk Koetter around, because he could have very well ended up in Philly if Tampa didn't fire Lovie Smith. I feel as though it's a matter of, you know, cementing the team around Wentz at this point and then letting Carson develop in a team that's already there. And granted, I know we're going more failed coaches, but if someone like Gus Bradley were to come in, he's definitely out in Jacksonville. This year's atrocious for them. What he was able to build the first couple years that has all fallen apart now, but the first couple years what he was building, if he could do that in Philly, you know, and you look at it, that's one that I can totally see in the Eagles, you know, like I said, going for that different mindset at head coach and seeing if it changes the course.
I don't even know if it's just the mindset than just a guy who just is, like, competent.
Yeah.
I mean, you threw the ball 48 times yesterday, and you had 11 runs.
Yeah.
And you're not going to protect a rookie quarterback when you do that. I mean, look at what they do in Dallas. Look at even what Cleveland does.
Yeah.
I mean, look at almost every rookie quarterback. I mean, they have protection, but Doug just doesn't do that. Carson Wentz has come out and said that his footwork is better, he sees the field better, he's able to read defenses better under center.
Yeah.
All the offense is majority shotgun.
Mm-hmm.
Like, there's a reason Andy Reid didn't let this guy call plays.
Yeah.
And I feel like that should have been a red flag. I mean, it was brought up, but no one really was like, you know, I think it should have been more of a red flag. The only reason, even though the struggles will probably hurt my statement recently, the only reason I would keep Doug Peterson around is to keep Schwartz around.
Yes.
And I know the defense has had its struggles. Pass rush has been slacking, but, I mean, it's tough to – I mean, you got to let the defense coordinator stay in for more than 1 year.
Yeah.
I mean, you look at almost any defensive coordinator ever, the stats get better after the first year, for the most part.
Yeah.
I mean, Dick LeBeau at Tennessee,
yeah,
much better after his first year. I mean, you got to let – I mean, if you keep the same core together, which I think there will be some cuts, there will be some new contracts. I think – I mean, Connor Barnes, you save like $7 million if you cut him. I think they'll redo his contract. He wants to be a lifer. But I think if you keep a guy like Schwartz around, I think it's worth something. But then again, can I deal with Doug?
More than that begs the question, could the Eagles pull essentially what Tampa Bay did and axe Doug and promote Schwartz?
I don't know.
I mean, granted, he's failed numerous times in Detroit, but
I don't know if I would be a fan of that. His teams are very undisciplined.
Yeah.
I know people are like, oh, Oakland's undisciplined. But, I mean, they have an electric offense. We don't have the pieces on offense
to do that yet.
Yeah. I think if you had to get rid of, like, Schwartz with Doug, I feel like I'd be more comfortable bringing in another offensive guy because then, again, we have the pieces on defense.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm pretty sure Adam Gase was the Eagles' first choice.
Okay.
From what I was reading over the, like, during the process when it was going on, and, like, he was a hot commodity. He goes to Miami, lackluster offense. They lose Miller. They lose, who was the receiver that they lost? Or did they bring in Kenny Stills? Or they got rid of Mike Wallace, right?
Yeah. Well, no, he had been gone for a year. He was in Minnesota last year.
Okay, yeah, you're right. But they lost Lamar Miller, who's having a great year in Houston. But they had defensive pieces. And now you're seeing what that team is doing, pushing for a wild card spot. I think they're in a wild card spot right now, if I'm not mistaken.
I think the loss to Baltimore may have knocked them out. I'm not 100% sure.
They are still in.
They're still in?
They're above Pittsburgh because the Ravens are still above. The Ravens won and put them in, so Miami was able to stay in because Pittsburgh, even though with the win, I think the tiebreaker somehow, or I'm looking at the conference stands and not the playoff. Oh, okay, they're one back. My bad. I apologize. They're one back of the Broncos. And, I mean, I don't know if I were the Eagles fans, I'd take 7-5 right outside the. So, I mean, I don't know if it was like, if they were kind of just like, hey, let's just see what happens. Like, we can also move on from it after 1 year. I don't know what Lawyer was thinking. I would like to hear some of his comments.
Yeah.
Like, we didn't get our guy. Let's just go with this guy. Maybe he'll surprise us. Maybe, like, we could always get rid of him after 1 year. He's a nobody.
Yeah.
I mean, and you're obviously, I see where you're saying with the Schwartz thing, but I don't know if that's what the team needs right now.
Yeah.
I mean, you look at what Matt Stafford is doing now when under Jim Caldwell and Jim Bob Cooter, whereas what was he doing under Schwartz? Yes, he was younger. I get that, but still, it just didn't seem to work.
Well, and I mean, the problem lies in that, do you want to set up a situation where, and don't get me wrong, I think, you know, Wentz is talented, and I think once he puts everything together, he's going to be a good quarterback. But do you want to run the risk, unless they can get someone that they're totally comfortable with, that's an offensive guy, that if he's, you know, he could be there for at least 2-3 years, the grace period, and then if he has success, even longer. I'm not sure, you know, like you said, Adam Gase would have been that type of guy. Come in, everybody knows he's going to be a good, you know, he's been praised for 2 years that he's going to be this great head coach. Doesn't get hired the year before, goes to Chicago, goes to Chicago with John Fox, then goes to Miami this year. And I think, could it, you know, like you said, I root for the failures of the Eagles because I don't want another good team. I'd like it to be the Giants and then one other team just to keep things interesting. And then the other two teams in the division at the bottom. But if I'm an Eagles fan, I'm hesitant on pulling the trigger on Doug right now. Just because, and I mean, look at recent examples, Alex Smith. I mean, number one overall, granted, out of Utah, you know, Rodgers should have went one in hindsight. But they changed offensive coordinators, what, 6 or 7 times before they got Harbaugh? And I mean, yeah, you can hire, you know, if they were to fire Doug, they could hire a Gus Bradley, a Sean McDermott. They're all defensive guys. So they're going to bring in an O coordinator, and if that O coordinator does well, they're out. They're going to get another job, and now you have another offensive coordinator. So I agree with you on that aspect of it needs to be an offensive guy if they do fire him. But I feel like it would need to be someone like a Gase that, you know, obviously he ain't leaving Miami now, but someone like him that could set it up where, you know, they're protected very much like Hugh Jackson. You knew Cleveland was going to be bad. But just a coach that's going to be protected and that, you know, if the team goes 6-10 next year under a new coach, like, you know, the coach is still fine. Mm-hmm. As opposed to, oh, this other offensive guy is struggling. Doug struggled last year. Let's fire this guy, too. And then all of a sudden you have 6 offensive coordinators in 6 years. And
yeah, but at the same time, he leaves San Francisco after Harbaugh came, and then he has another offensive coordinator and continues his success.
Yeah.
I think the key is finding someone that works with Wentz. I mean, really, if you get rid of Doug, you can keep Frank Reich because no one's really knocking the door down to get him.
Yeah.
I don't know if you take away the play calling from him. I don't know if you, like, I mean, there's some calls that just don't make sense. There's so many times this year where I just was dumbfounded and going, what?
Yeah.
Like, how does this make sense? Let's throw a pass 3 yards behind the line of scrimmage and then lose yards and then not kick the field goal? Like, really? And I don't, like, they're all not on the same page either, Wentz and Peterson. Peterson blamed it, Wentz's performance, on mechanics. Wentz didn't say it was mechanics.
Yeah.
Wentz said things happen when you throw that much. Like, think bad things are going to happen. Is that a shot at Doug? I don't know. Because right now, if I'm picking my future, it ain't Doug Peterson.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know. I mean, I don't know what to say other than it may have just been a bad hire. And as long as you don't keep it around.
I don't think it was a bad hire as much as it was, I mean, aside from Malarkey, who got, you know, the interim tag taken off from Tennessee. If I remember correctly, you guys were the last ones to hire a coach.
Yeah.
I think it was just a matter of who was left.
But, I mean, you look at who was left, and you could have went Lovie Smith.
Yeah.
Granted, defensive guy, but you could have brought in an offensive guy.
Yeah.
There's plenty of people out there, and I think maybe they were just like, it would have been easy. It's easier to bring in a guy like Doug Peterson and be like, oh, you know what? We tried a new guy instead of bring in another guy that's already been a head coach.
Yeah.
I think it's easier to move on from a new guy than it is a guy that was a head coach.
Yeah.
And I think that may be what they were looking at. I don't know. I have no idea. I know it was. I mean, I was never a fan of the hire.
Well, but
it's not being good. It's not a good one so far.
Like you said, you look at it and Gase went to Miami. Hugh Jackson went to Cleveland. McAdoo stayed with the Giants. You know, Cutter stayed in Tampa Bay. You know. Were there other O coordinators? Could you hired Josh McDaniels? Sure. But like you said, we know what Josh McDaniels is. He sucks. You know, if you were able to pry Matt Patricia away, sure. You know, again, trying someone that hasn't been a head coach. But wait for this to come.
But at
on.
The same time, Pete Carroll was better at this after the second time.
There he is.
Let's see what Birch has to say. This will be something.
What's up, Birch? You're on Monday Night Lights.
I'm speechless. I think that's appropriate. I'm speechless after yesterday.
I mean, it was a terrible performance, and it seems like the players quit on him.
Yeah.
So
I think that's the conclusion. I think they, you know what? They quit on Doug, and they quit on themselves, and they quit on this fan base. You know, it's like one thing if that had been a healthy Cincinnati team with Gio Bernard and AJ Green and all them. They allowed guys like Brandon LaFell to tear them apart. And it's just, you know, Cincinnati all year has struggled. And I mean, they're a good team, especially when they're healthy. But that I just can't even put into words. And it's like, okay, you know what? Maybe they weren't going to make the playoffs. You know, you can face that reality, but to lose like that yesterday, just, you can't even put it into words.
I think for me, it's not just the fact, like, we all knew it wasn't going to be a good season, but the seeing the Eagles go backwards. And...
Yeah, that's exactly the point, like, Ray Dittinger had made post-game was, you know, okay, the Eagles started 3-0. Even before that, you kind of just assumed that it was going to be, you know, you had the rookie quarterback, you had the rookie head coach, so you were going to take wins and losses as they came. But, you know, okay, so they started 3-0. You would expect them to continue to improve. Now, I'm not saying go 12-4 and, you know, go 6-0 in the division, but you at least want to see improvement. For them to regress as much as they have is really concerning.
Yeah, and I have no other answer other than they have abandoned the run. They don't let Wentz get under center nearly as much as they should. I mean, offensive line has been it was okay for there for a while, and now it's starting to struggle. I know Vitae's out. I know they're kind of had to shuffle around. Chemistry was probably lost, but still, I think there's got to be more of an effort on both sides, either, whether it's the players or on Doug's side, because, I mean, some of those play calls, what he was deciding to do, it just didn't make sense a lot.
No, and you hit the nail on the head. I just, you know, it's one thing to throw the ball 50 times one week, okay? You know, you can kind of understand maybe a team is weak in the secondary, or you just have some kind of blueprint against a team that you can throw against them. When you throw the ball 60 times and run the ball 19 times, when Cincinnati's run defense all season has been poor, that just makes no sense to me. And it makes no sense to me because you're asking your rookie quarterback to do to pretty much be everything. You know, you're putting your rookie quarterback in harm's way of getting blitz, getting hit. I just, for the life of me, I do not understand Doug Peterson's play calling the last several weeks. I don't get it. And yeah, you know what? There's got to be consistency, not only with the offense, but the defense. I mean, again, we're talking about penalties just killing this team. The Achilles heel of the Eagles all season has been their penalties. And one other thing that's really starting to bother me is, you know, okay, so Fletcher Cox, I can kind of understand, you know, not putting up the numbers that he's put up. He's going to get double teamed, hell, even triple teamed at times. But shouldn't that free up guys like Connor Barwin, Vinny Curry, Brandon Graham, and Benny Logan to get to the quarterback more?
It should. But for some reason, this pass rush has decreased astronomically. And Hicks only has 2 tackles yesterday. But Kelvin still is not good.
I'll make a Christmas donation to the Eagles charity of their choice if they do not play Leo McKelvin for the rest of the season.
Well,
I am so beyond. And you know what? I forget who said it today, and it's going to kill me. But, you know, you look at how the Eagles have addressed. Seth Joyner said it. How the Eagles have addressed corners lately. You know, you went out and you signed Nnamdi. You signed DRC. You signed Byron Maxwell, Kerry Williams. You know, go back a little bit further. They took the risk on Asante. I think Asante was a pretty good corner here. He had the safety help. He was in a great scheme.
He jumped a little too many routes for my
liking.
He did.
But you know what? I think the thing with Asante was he did have the safety help that allowed him to do that and the scheme that allowed him to do that. But yeah, he took a lot of risks. It's like the thing is, the last time the Eagles nailed the draft in the corner in terms of cornerbacks was really Lito and Sheldon, I think.
Well, yeah, no doubt. I mean, Lito was the last first-round pick that was a corner for the Eagles. I mean, they would buy low on guys. Andy Reid's process was you build up front, and then you try and find guys later. I mean,
yeah.
And I like Jalen Mills. I mean, you found him in the 7th round, but I think there needs to be more depth there. And I like Carroll, but he's probably not an outside guy. I think I would like him better in the slot. You got to get rid of McKelvin. I think Ron Brooks will probably get cut as well. I think you have to go corner in the first round.
Yeah, well, there's no doubt about it. And I think this will make for a great discussion over the next couple months of, you know, whether the Eagles need a draft for need or for best player available. Because, you know, you see all these reports, oh, best player available might be Dalvin Cook, Reuben Foster, Mike Williams, if the Eagles get lucky, if Minnesota keeps falling. You know, but in this situation, I think the Eagles have to take the risk and take the best corner available. I mean, this secondary, you know, Rodney McLeod and Malcolm Jenkins can't do everything. And these corners continuously getting torched like they have. You're just not going to win very many football games if that continues, especially like Lewis and you and I were talking about it over the weekend with, you know, the Eagles have to face Dez Bryant and Odell Beckham twice a year amongst the many wide receivers in the NFC alone. And I really think that 100% cornerback has got to be addressed in the first round. They've got to stop with this free agent nonsense of trying to get these cheap guys and then saying, oh, well, you know, Jim Schwartz knows them. Doug Peterson knows. I don't care who knows who. They need you build through the draft, and they've got to hit on a corner in the draft.
I mean, I won't. I'm not really extremely like mad at the McKelvin Brooks signings because you can get out of them after 1 year with no cap hit, and they weren't a lot of money. But the whole aspect of bringing in corners that haven't really shown much, I get, and I'm just tired of paying corners a lot of money, so let's draft them and let's pay a receiver a lot of money. I would like, but not like a speed receiver. There's talk about DeSean Jackson possibly coming back.
Yeah, I wanted to ask you about that.
I wouldn't touch it. Waste of space, waste of money. All he does is run down the field and catch one pass for 59 yards and doesn't help your team win. I need a possession receiver.
Yeah, no, Tim, I totally agree with you, but I was going to throw this at you. If you could get DeSean cheap, but you knew that you could also get maybe a Terrell Pryor, a Michael Floyd, I mean, would you do that as a number two option?
No, I wouldn't bring in DeSean at all.
Okay, I mean, fair enough. I mean, I'm on board with you. I'll always love DeSean. I mean, sour grapes with the whole Washington thing, but you know, at 30 years old with the injuries, and he's not the same player he was 4 or 5 years ago. I mean, yeah, I'd rather them spend the money on a Pryor, Jeffrey, Floyd, and then turn their attention to, I think, I'm praying that he is there in the second round, is someone like a John Ross or a Corey Davis.
Yeah, I mean, I think you just... What they are going to do in the draft is up to them. But I would go corner, sign a big time receiver. That'll probably lead you to cutting some guys, free up some space, or redoing some deals. And to be honest, I don't know if I'd go receiver second round. I would probably.
I feel like you can get a running back there.
Yeah, I mean, you could go running back, but I like Wendell. I think he's your starter next year because I think you cut Matthews.
Yes.
You still have Sproles. I think you wait on running back. I think you go line. You go offensive line.
Yeah.
Because you're getting rid of Peters. You're going to have probably – your line next year is probably going to be Lane left tackle. Then you're going to have Brooks, Kelsey, Barbara, and Vitae. Because I don't think Isaac Samalo – I don't even know how to say his last name. I don't think he's ready yet, but you need linemen and – depth is, I mean, especially with Lane Johnson already getting suspended 10 games twice in his first, 4 years?
If he gets caught again, what is it, a year?
Maybe 2 years. I'm not actually sure.
I think it's 2 years, yeah.
So you got to get depth. I mean, you have to.
I wouldn't be
mad about going back-to-back corners or corner linebacker because Kendricks is getting cut, so you need depth there. I mean...
I agree. I actually was thinking maybe the second round. I'm under the impression I think Connor Barwin might get cut. You know, maybe they want to address edge rusher and get some depth there. But, I mean, I could totally get on board with that plan, you know, going corner, maybe getting linebacker, offensive lineman second round. But, you know, the thing is, I think, yeah, you could probably Band-Aid the situation at wide receiver with, you know, a big splash in free agency. But, you know, there's no secret. This team has got it. They need to nail the draft. And it's encouraging, I think, because, you know, when you look at it, 5 rookies on this team are contributing. You know, I'm counting Big V because he did play several games. He really started to improve. I mean, you've got Wentz, Smallwood, Vitae, Jalen Mills, and Samalo has filled in. in a couple games. So, you know, to have five members of a draft class produce in the first year and play pretty well, I think that's really encouraging. And, you know, they plain and simple, they have to nail the draft if they're going to be successful.
Yeah, no doubt. But yep. I would rather – I don't hate getting a big free agent signing at receiver.
Not at all.
Because you have to keep Aguilar because you lose money if you cut him. You're going to have Turner. I mean, he's looked pretty good.
Matthews for another year.
Matthews. You're probably going to play Treggs because why not? I mean, you're paying him literally nothing, and he's got speed. And then I think you sign a guy. I mean, I think that's what you do.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, and it'll be interesting, too, because, you know, I do think that Jordan Matthews could be a really good slot receiver and create mismatches there if the Eagles can get a one and a two via free agency and the draft. You know, I just think it's going to be real interesting, too, because now the heat is on Doug, and the honeymoon is long over. So, you know, they're going to have to get some things moving quickly because – I mean, he's really on a hot seat right now.
Oh, yeah, no doubt. What happens this offseason with Doug is going to tell you how Jeffrey Lurie thought of him when they signed him. Was he just he wasn't even their third choice. From an article I just read, it was Gase, McAdoo.
Was that the NJ.com article?
Yeah, by Matt Lombardo.
Yeah, I saw that one too. Yeah. And that's really interesting. I mean, Adam Gase was the guy I wanted right from the get-go. I mean, you know, we flirted with the idea of Sean Payton, but, you know, that was kind of a pipe dream. But Adam Gase was really the guy that I wanted when this whole thing started. And look at what he's done with Ryan Tannehill and a patchwork offensive line. I mean, Dolphins are in playoff contention. But, yeah, you know, this offseason I really do think is going to be a very critical offseason for a number of reasons. I mean, you know, I've defended him, and I still will defend him in certain circumstances. But, you know, Carson Wentz, he's regressed. And I think there's a lot of things that he needs to clean up in the offseason, his mechanics. But, you know,
he doesn't think so. He doesn't think he needs to clean up his mechanics. Only Peterson thinks that.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, maybe
you shouldn't throw the ball 60 times and only run the ball 11 times.
Oh, no, I totally agree with you. There's no justification on that. I mean, I think there's a couple I think he does have tunnel vision at times, and I think that can be corrected. I mean, I don't know. I never played the position, and, you know, it's really interesting because, you know, Doug was a quarterback, so I would have thought that – and Frank Reich was a quarterback too. So it's like I would have
both
thought
backups.
That Wentz – yeah, but at least you would have thought that with them having knowledge of the game, that Wentz would have slowly progressed, not regressed.
You think with the 11th, ranked 11th in rushing yards per game at 109.8, that they would actually run the ball and not have Wentz in the shotgun all the time, where the defensive coordinator can just, I think it's Paul Gunther for the Bengals, right?
For Cincy, yeah. Yep.
So he can just decide when he wants to drop 8 in coverage. Or when he wants to say, now we're going to act like we're dropping 8 in coverage and bring 7.
Yeah.
Bring 6.
But you know what else confuses me, too, is you have a rookie in Wendell Smallwood. Why wouldn't you run the ball more to see what you got in the kid?
Because we have a terrible coach.
I know. but I mean, like, common sense would tell you, okay, you know, I have a 5th-round draft pick who's a running back. And, you know, he was pretty good, had some character issues, which is why he fell. But, you know, in the times that he's been on the field, he's shown you that he's progressing and he's explosive at times. Why wouldn't I run the ball maybe 20 times in the game and see what I got with him?
Granted,
I don't know.
Granted, Smallwood was our leading rusher the past 3 weeks with 48, 37, and 19. So, I mean,
that's just pathetic. I mean, I there's no other way I can say it. That is just pathetic. I mean, you know, look, I got on Andy Reid's case because, you know, he abandoned the run at times. One thing you can't say negatively about Chip is he did run the ball, sometimes a little too much when it wasn't working. But
maybe that's why I love Chip so much. I love running the ball.
Football 101 tells you that the run opens up the pass game. Like, I don't for the life of me, and I'm on board with you. You cannot throw the ball 60 times and not run the ball. That is pathetic that those are their rushing totals. That is pathetic.
No doubt. Do you got a prediction?
And I'm getting more and more angry the more I think about it. Like, you need to run the ball.
Yeah, no, I agree with you 100%. Do you have a prediction for this week at home against Washington?
I think it's going to be another embarrassment. Washington's playing for their playoff lives, so I'm going to go Redskins 34, Eagles 14.
Oh, wow. That's a blowout right there.
I have absolutely zero confidence that they're going to beat the Redskins. Zero. Washington, you know what? Kirk Cousins, I've been his hardest critic, I think, and, you know, they still have a chance to make that last wild card spot, so I would expect them to play a little more edgier, you know. The way that the Eagles' effort was on Sunday was an embarrassment. It was lethargic, and it was total crap. So I'm going to go with Washington here, and I'm not even second-guessing it.
I'm going Eagles 24-20 because I hate Washington. I would never pick them. That's my.
I'll go 24-17 Redskins. You know, just because I want to be realistic. I hope the Eagles win, but I need to be realistic.
I've never heard you say that before. It's been a long time since.
Hey, they're up our ass. You're not, so.
Yeah, well, who knows? You know, maybe all of a sudden the Eagles just win four in a row, but I guess I'm living in an alternate universe there. But thank God for the Flyers.
That's fine. You play Dallas there. We can go 3-1. It'd be perfectly fine.
Oh, thank God for the Flyers. They're keeping me sane right now.
Yeah, 5 in a row. They're playing really well. Matt Reed's out for 4 weeks, but other than that, they're playing really well. Steve Mason, I think, was named.
I think Lawton got sent down today,
yeah,
too. I think I saw.
Taylor Lear. Yeah. Called up. Yeah.
No problem, because Provy and Konechny have been the staple of the process.
So, yeah.
I had to throw one process joke in, otherwise it wasn't a show.
True. I mean, you can't. True. Well, I mean, I said this to Lewis off there, and this is the only time I'll say it. But the process for the Sixers ended when Hinkie was resigned or fired or whatever way you want to look at it.
I don't know if I've said this on air yet, and Lewis, I've said it to you, but you know what? The Philadelphia 76ers have done a complete disservice to Samuel Hinkie. They need to put a statue of that man outside the Wells Fargo Center. They need to put a patch of his face on those jerseys because this man
instead
has put
this team... Instead of the
StubHub logo? Screw that StubHub logo. You know, this man needs to be honored for the sacrifices that he made to put the Sixers in this position. It's a beautiful thing. And actually, I wanted real quick to ask you, did you guys see that Nick Stauskas' dad is now claiming that Joel Embiid has to pay Stauskas royalties because Stauskas was the original process?
I mean, Stauskas is awesome. I mean, I'm not going to
say anything. Nicky Sauce. You know what? And that was a trade that Sam Hinkie was crucified for. And you know what? It took him a year, but Stauskas is finally
He was not
together.
Crucified for that deal at all. He literally got nothing. Like, he gave up nothing. He gave up two.
I saw. I remember a couple people
foreigners.
Saying that we gave up too much for nothing.
He gave up two foreigners that aren't ever going to come into the league, and we got a pick swap, and we got Stauskas, Jason Thompson, and Carl Landry. Even Howard Eskin, who hates Sam Hinkie, said it was a good deal because you gave up nothing and you could cook on salary. You got picks. You got a pick swap.
Yeah,
and
no,
you got Stauskas.
I agree.
What,
it was a great trade.
What people were saying is that Stauskas would never be anything, but they were never saying that the trade was a bad trade.
Well, Nicky Sauce is just everything, and Embiid is everything. And you know what? I'm Lewis. One day you are going to believe in the process, and you are going to believe that the process was a great thing.
I look forward to the unicorn knocking the Sixers out of the division lead every year.
You know what? I think what needs to happen, if I may request this, next week, can I get time to talk about the Sixers? And I will present my case as to why the process will get the Sixers a championship in 5 years.
I actually have it less than that, but that's fine. Yeah. I mean, we can do that. We can do that next week.
At least within 5 years. So next week, I'd love to finally talk basketball, the sport I actually played and have a little bit more knowledge in. And I promise by the end of the show, I'm going to get Lewis to at least not hate the word process.
That's going to be the first time.
That'll be a good way to end the day after a final. So
I look forward to it.
All right, Birch. Thanks for calling in, man.
All right, gentlemen.
Take care. I guess I'm going to have to talk against the process next week, right?
I have no problem doing that.
Because, like... I'm the process trust. Well, I was a process.
Well, the process trusted. Died.
Process is over, but I'm 100% Sixers fan. Watched the Sixers the past 4 years, even when they started the tank, and when they still. I went to a game when they still had Drew Holiday, Spencer Hollis before they moved him at the deadline. I got into an argument with Charlie Villanueva when he was on the Pistons.
Totally has no eyebrows.
I didn't realize that I messed up.
He has a condition.
Charlie Villanueva is now my favorite player, one of my favorite players, because I was a stupid ice scorer then. But
could be Corey Maggette. He follows me on Twitter.
Yeah. Hey, he followed me too. I don't know if he still follows me. Probably not. But anyway, I think he'll be too out there on the process. We might say Okafor is a good player, which is wrong.
No, he hates Okafor.
Okay, that's fine.
I've told you, I like go on Twitter during Sixers games. It's like I know, the same tweet back to back.
I get it, but at the same time, is if he's trying to prove you wrong, he may try and make a case for Okafor when really there is no case for Okafor. But we'll see. Sixers are winning by 7, and Okafor isn't playing. Works out that way.
No, Corey Maggette doesn't follow me anymore.
Oh man, he was doing it just to get some love, I guess. He was like, "Hey, remember me?
Remember
follow
me?
A bunch of people," and they're like, "Oh God, Corey Maggette. I forgot he existed." But since Birch took us over, we'll just go the last 15 minutes. We'll talk the or 14 minutes now. We'll talk the playoff, or you know, let's just talk other NFL.
Okay.
And then we'll talk the playoff. So your Giants win streak was broke.
Yes.
Do you think that was just them facing a good team, even though Pitt struggled, or did they beat themselves?
I think Eli beat the Giants. I think everybody else played perfectly fine. It's just a matter of when Eli likes to become what we've seen the last 2 years, as opposed to the guy that we've seen, you know, in 2007, 2011. We play like that. I mean, you know, there's just no, I mean, the offense is just too centered around him at this point. I mean, you have no run game, so it's not like you could say, here, Eli doesn't have it, Rashad, carry the game. You know, if Eli doesn't have it, they come out flat like they did. And, I mean, Eric Flowers is awful. If you'd like to give up Lane Johnson for his for risk of suspension, we'll take him. Because Eric Flowers, I know this is sports, not political, but he's not my left tackle. So there's that.
He was at guard when he first came in the league, right? And then they moved
Playing him at right tackle when he first came in last year.
And then
they cut Beatty to move him to left, brought Beatty back, and now Beatty kind of plays both as a backup.
Okay. And do you think maybe a move into guard would help him? Because originally when he came in the league, that's what everyone thought he would be better as.
Yeah.
But obviously you guys had a glaring hole at tackle.
Yeah.
And then you still had to keep Will Beatty when you had a hole at tackle. And then you moved him to the blind side. Do you think a move in at guard would help him? Granted, they could get a tackle. I mean, Jason Peters will most likely be on the market after this year.
Yeah. I don't know. I feel like they would explore getting a left tackle in free agency. I mean, the bad part is that we're halfway decent this year and we'll probably make at least a wild card. So Cam Robinson essentially out of the question at this point. But, you know, I look at it and, you know, if they can get a, you know, if they could, you know, like Birch said with you guys and the receivers, if we can sign one and then draft one at tackle and have an inside of Pugh, Richburg, and Flowers, I'd be okay with that. That would be a solid middle of the line. Problem is, I still feel that despite the strides the Giants have made, there's still a lot of holes to fill in free agency this year. In free agency in the draft. Obviously, there's a bit of money, but, you know, fingers crossed they bring back Pierre Paul.
How many fingers you crossing?
8.5. he's got you there. But, you know, hopefully they bring him back, keep that D-line together. But, yeah, I think if you can sign one, draft one, if you can get, say, or hell, even trade, if, you know, if you can get Joe Thomas and then draft someone and, you know, second, third round, that's setting you up all right. you know, obviously that drafted guy would have to pan out and Joe Thomas's skills wouldn't have to go off a cliff. But I think, you know, and similar to what I said a couple of weeks ago with, I think it was the Monday before the trade deadline. And I said I was against Joe Thomas getting traded because eventually they're going to have their franchise quarterback. And you're going to have to keep him on his feet in Cleveland. And obviously the Giants have one right now. And, you know, whether they take one this year, take one next year in the draft and start working on him. You know, not that Joe Thomas would be around if you draft a guy next year and he's got to wait 2 or 3 years for the guy. But, you know, I think adding someone first off would be a massive help. Because even if the rookie doesn't pan out, you still have Flowers.
Yeah.
So
I'm looking at a couple of names. Let's see. Where are you at right now? They have you taking a DN out of Illinois, this mock draft I'm looking at. Some of the tackles in free agency, obviously you have Whitworth and Winston, both 30. I mean, by the time they hit it, it'll be 34, 35. You have Matt Khalil, who will be a big name out there. He's coming off an injury, but at the same time, maybe someone to look at. Sebastian
could get franchise tagged, though.
True. Sebastian Vollmer from New England. He's 32. Bill Belichick doesn't really like to spend a lot of money on older players.
Yeah.
That could be – I mean, he could use Gronk to get someone back for the offensive line. Well, we continue to talk about that as Gronk is out. I think there's a possibility of them moving him. Ryan Reif from Detroit. He's under 30. Jordan Mills from Buffalo. I think he is – I'm not sure if he starts or not, but he is only 25. Jake Long, he really has fallen off, but he could be a buy low, let's see what he can do kind of guy.
And the kind of – you know, like I said, a guy like that would kind of be like a mentor for Flowers, and if they were to draft somebody and just, you know, it's how you play.
Mm-hmm. Charles from Tampa Bay, he's 32. So, I mean, if you're going to look at a guy, it's going to be – probably over 30.
Yeah.
But at the same time, like you said, if you do the sign draft kind of thing, you could be looking at just a guy that has to hold his own for a year.
Yeah.
I think Jason Peters will be out there. He may be, I know he's up there in age, but he's having a very, very good year, regardless of that. He may be a cheaper, however, older option. I mean, offensive linemen are always a hot commodity, but one that's able to have that success at that age, assuming he doesn't retire, which there was no indication that he is. He could be a guy that they look at, but
yeah. I mean, my worry is that I worry that the spending this year on Vernon, on Snacks, on Jenkins may have been a panic move by Jerry Reese, and that they needed to do something because if they went 6-10 this year, he was gone. So, I feel like that I'm almost worried. They went after Okun. They went after who else did they go after this offseason? I forget. I know one of them was definitely Russell Okun. They tried to land him.
Was he a tackle?
Yeah.
Trying to think who. Let's load it up right now. Was it Beecham from Pitt?
Yes, Beecham. You know, they tried to land both of them, didn't get them.
I mean, hey, if they were going to get any, if they're going to get a tackle, last year was pretty good for tackles. I mean, Bobby Massey, Donald Penn, Mitchell Schwartz, Beecham, Okun. I mean, those are some pretty good names.
Yeah. I'm 90% sure it was Beecham and Okun. It definitely wasn't Mitchell Schwartz because we screwed over his brother, so that he wouldn't even talk to us. But it, you know, it shows that Jerry Reese knows it's an issue and knows that it needs to be addressed, because Eric Flowers, at that point, was only coming off of his first year. Now we know he might not be that good, and now, you know, obviously, you cut Beattie, you brought him back because you couldn't sign anybody else. But like I said, they show the urgency and show that they think that, you know, left tackle needs to be addressed. But the question's going to be, is Jerry Reese going to be that aggressive in free agency if his back isn't against the wall?
But then again, if you don't address these issues and not everyone has a great year as they're having this year.
Yeah.
Like, what if Collins takes a step down? What if Pierre Paul, the age starts to get to him where you don't re-sign him?
Yeah.
What if then, again, it's like, oh, Giants were one-hit wonder because they had some new pieces and they really played well all together. And now this year, not so much. They fall back again.
Yeah.
I mean, that's what he's got. That's what Reese has got to look at. I mean, 1 year of success is great, but to stay, you got to keep it up.
Yeah.
Because when you look at a resume, if it's 6-10, 6-10, 6-10, 7-9, 8-8, 9-7, and then this year, what, maybe 10-6, 11-5, and then you go back to a 6-10.
Yeah.
I mean, congrats, man. But overall, it's not looking good on the.
Well, no, but the problem that I see is that if they make the playoffs this year, okay, let's say they make past the wild card round. Being realistic, make it past the wild card round, losing the divisional round.
Mm-hmm.
Then that just bought Jerry Reese at least 2 more years. Because they're not going to cut him after next year unless they go 2-14, because you made the moves to get us relevant again.
Yeah, but what if then you don't make a move and you have a bad season and you're thinking...
Oh, but then it's just going to be chalked up as... Yeah, you know, a bad year.
Yeah, but why didn't you make the moves when we had the chance to? Why aren't you protecting Manning, who's now 34, 35?
Yeah.
I mean, if anything, you can justify a tackle signing even if it doesn't pan out. Because, hey, can you blame me for trying to protect our franchise?
Trying to protect Eli, yeah.
I mean, that's why we kept Ben McAdoo. Because Eli Manning excelled under him. We want our franchise to excel. Even if Ben McAdoo wasn't doing this good.
Yeah.
You still say, hey, can you blame me? We're trying to – you saw what he could do as an offense coordinator. We're trying to better him. We're trying to better our franchise with our franchise player. And I think that's why I think you got to make the move, because you can protect that move. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I don't know. It just seems like the Giants are one of those teams that – can go up 1 year and be in the playoffs and make a run, and the next year be at the bottom of the division.
Well, I think that's the thing, is as long as they have Eli, they're going to be able to do that. The question is, and I mentioned this with the Eagles, I want them to really make an effort to cement the team around the quarterback. I would love for one day to be in a situation like the Seahawks were a few years back, where they, granted they were younger, they hadn't really shown everything yet, but they had all the people. They had Sherman, Chancellor, Thomas, Wagner, you know, added Harvin, and then drafted a quarterback in the third round and just kind of put him in. And just see, I would love for the Giants to set the team up that way, and you know, we could take you know, down the road, whoever, you know, third round pick out of Alabama, you know, Florida, whatever, Luke Del Rio. I would love for them to just like, yeah, Luke Del Rio's there in the fourth round. Let's take him. You know, Eli retired this year. We're gonna try to stopgap it. Oh man, he's playing well. You know, he has Odell Beckham. Things happen. You know, I'd love for that to happen one day, but just, I know the Giants, it never will.
Yeah, but you gotta start looking at it now, because think about it. If you start adding in some pieces and then drafting well, by the time these pieces that you signed, they'll be starting to get off a contract.
Yeah.
And now you can sign the pieces that come in, and like you said, they haven't really done much to show that they will do that. But I mean, you can't just have a one-hit wonder, because. Yeah. There's so many teams that do that, and it takes a lot to be up there consistently. So we'll take our first break. We'll come back. We'll talk college football playoff. It won't be a heated discussion because it's out, so what is there to discuss?
Yeah.
Not as much as last 2 weeks, but there is some things that I would like to say. And also the Heisman finalist came out, and Lewis would be very happy to see. I don't know if you already saw it.
It haven't yet.
During Showtime, Lewis will be very happy to see what player is a finalist. We'll be right back on Monday Night Lights, 101.7 WDSR. Monday Lights, 101.7 WDSR. We are back. We're going to be talking Heisman finalist first, because that I feel like that will have more conversation
yes.
about it than the college football playoff, because I just want to make a few points. Lewis is going to bask in the glory of Ohio State making it 3. Like I said in the beginning of the show, I think they should have been 4, just by principle. But we'll talk about that. So the finalists for the Heisman, they decided to bring five this year, which, did they bring five last year?
I think last year was three.
Okay, because it has been switching. It used to be five, and then all of a sudden they switched to three, and it was three for a while. And now it's back to five. It is Lamar Jackson from Louisville, Baker Mayfield from Oklahoma.
Mayfield.
One of Lewis's favorite players. Jabril Peppers from Michigan. Deshaun Watson from Clemson, and Dede Westbrook. Not many guys know that name. He's a receiver from Oklahoma, fifth most receiving yards in the entire NCAA with 16 touchdowns. Kind of Will Fuller numbers, but for some reason Westbrook goes, and Will Fuller was not invited.
Oh, so you're just bitter because Will Fuller never got invited.
I just think if you have the same amount of stats and you're about the same in the NCAA, I just think it's only fair. No? I guess NCAA is not about being fair.
No.
As we'll talk about with the playoff, but... who are your favorites? Who do you think ends up winning it? And you might as well just give an order 1 to 5 at that point.
Well, obviously, I think it's no secret who's winning. I think you'll agree with me. It's Lamar Jackson this year. If I had to go 1 to 5, I would go Jackson, Watson, Mayfield, Peppers, Westbrook.
Jackson, Watson, Peppers? Or
Mayfield, Peppers.
Okay, yeah, I kind of agree with you there. I see Lamar Jackson winning it. The only thing that I think I could see happening is because Watson's in the playoff.
And Watson beat him?
Yeah, that he could win it. However, if you've watched... I don't know how many Clemson games or Louisville games you've watched. I've seen enough. And every time I've seen both teams play, I feel like Lamar Miller has played better. Watson does not look as exciting this year as he did last year.
Yeah.
I think some of his the things that made him not...
He wasn't that exciting last year. They just won.
Well, yeah. And
I think he came on in that national title game, and it brought everybody's attention.
And it was he was a new team, but I guess the same excitement... because they were there already.
Yeah.
Or, I mean, but some of his throws as well, they weren't, I don't know, he just didn't seem the same. I mean, his stats were better last year. He rushed more last year, was more efficient runner for more yards. He had more yards. He actually only threw four more passes this year. For four less and completed four less. So, and he had 200 more yards last year, two less touchdowns, two less interceptions, a higher rating, more rushing touchdowns, more yards per carry last year rather than this year. So, I mean, can you give a guy a Heisman after he goes down in stats?
Yeah.
I don't really see how you could do that.
I mean, I could see it if Lamar Jackson didn't come on the way he did, because I don't think there's another player in the country that is close to the two of them. You know, obviously last year it was Henry, right? Yeah, because they had the two Heismans back to back in Tennessee. You know, if no one comes out like Lamar Jackson has, then yeah, I'm giving it to Watson, even though he went down, because it's, you know, a year to year thing. You know, as much as I love Mayfield, he's not up to caliber with Deshaun Watson.
He is equal to who, as you said in the break? Mayfield is.
Why do I forget this already?
Colt McCoy. You said that
Colt McCoy. He's going to be a finalist every year and never actually win the thing.
Yeah, I mean, and I think that's viable. I mean, you get that. I mean, if you're going to go to five finalists, I mean, you're going to get a lot more Colt McCoys.
Yeah.
Which I get why they went to three, because now you only have two losers instead of four.
Yeah. Hey, Colt McCoy did it with three finalists, though.
Oh, that's true. That's right. I forget. Was that he was one of the first years that did three, wasn't
he? Yeah. He got third, and then Tebow got second, and Bradford won the Heisman.
That's right. Sammy B. But, yeah, I mean, if you look at Lamar Jackson, he kind of burst on the scene the same way Watson did last year, where it's after his after his freshman year, or was that last year was Watson's freshman year?
No, last year was his sophomore year.
So after his freshman year, you're like, all right, you could see potential in this kid. But, I mean, nothing, anything special. But Lamar Jackson, 12 touchdowns, 8 interceptions, 11 rushing touchdowns his freshman year. This year, 30 touchdowns, 9 picks, 21 rushing touchdowns.
Yeah.
Like, you can't argue with those stats. I mean, he was the most electric player in college football.
Yes.
At times, he was the reason Louisville won.
Yeah.
And I think if you don't have Lamar Jackson as your quarterback, Louisville does not have as good of a season as they did.
No.
I think they ended up with two losses.
I think so. Two or three, yeah.
It was Houston and
Clemson.
I think that might have been in. That might have been it. Oh, no, sorry. Kentucky last year.
Kentucky, yeah.
So, I mean, if they want to pick the best player on the best team, I think Watson gets it. If they want to pick the best player, I think you give it to Lamar Jackson. So, like you, I'd go Lamar Jackson, Watson second. I switched up 3 and 4.
You have Peppers.
Peppers, and Mayfield, and then Westbrook.
I'm interested to see. I don't know about you, and I know they release this after, I guess, Saturday, the Heisman ceremony.
Well, they'll probably, like the full standings?
Yeah.
They'll probably release that probably that night.
Yeah, like right after that. I'm interested to see who finished sixth, who, like, just missed the cutoff that D.D. Westbrook got in, because I feel like it could be a lot of people. I feel like there's a lot of people that deserve to be there at fifth other than D.D. Westbrook, who has his quarterback there. So you really have no chance of winning, because the only reason for your success is because of your quarterback. And I think you could have looked at Jalen Hurts from Alabama, Jake Browning, Humphrey, I think his name is, from San Diego State.
Yeah, he's the second leading rusher. It's Humphrey.
Humphrey.
And then even Deontay Freeman.
Yeah.
I mean, he was a leading rusher. And I know both of them didn't play on great teams, but, I mean, if you're going to pick a guy to finish fifth, like, why not?
Yeah, or could it be Saquon Barkley? Six. I mean, he could definitely be up there. I'm interested to see, like, who finished where and how many people were close to Westbrook. Because I feel like that's what it's going to be. I feel like when they tally up all the votes, it's going to be like a one or two vote thing between, like, D.D. Westbrook at 5 and then, like, potentially 6, 7, and 8. I feel like it's going to be that close, and somehow, like, there must have just been people showing more love to the Big 12 because they didn't get a representative in the playoff again. Like, I feel like that's what it's going to come down to.
Yeah, I think the problem also with putting Westbrook in, I feel like that's, like, good to see a receiver in there because you don't see it much, because only 3 wide receivers have won it ever.
Yeah.
You had Desmond Howard, you had Tim Brown, Notre Dame kid, and then, I'm trying to think, 1972 Johnny Rogers, who played both wide receiver and running back for Nebraska. So, I mean, wide receivers don't get a lot of hype because a lot of time their quarterback is winning it.
Exactly. And, I mean, like I said, when you have, you know, I would understand if Mayfield didn't also crack the top 5, but your quarterback is on stage with you.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you have no chance of winning because your quarterback's there. You know, I could see if he was, you know, an electric special teams player on top of it and then was, you know, Oklahoma's number one receiver. But, you know, considering we hadn't heard of the guy before we looked it up.
Yeah, I mean, unless you're like an Oklahoma fan, you don't really know the guy by name. He has 4 punt returns this year and 1 for a touchdown. He has 4 for 79. The 1 was for 71, so then he had 3 for 8. I mean, he's thrown 2 passes.
Yeah, like, that was the thing with Desmond, was that he wasn't the best wide receiver, necessarily, but just, you know, an electric special teams guy.
Oh, yeah, no doubt. Let's see. He played every game. I mean, 16 touchdowns. He did, and he is hurt now, so he won't be playing in their bowl game. So, I mean, if he wins, we're not going to still be able to watch him. But yeah, I think it was just kind of like we haven't had a receiver in a while.
Yeah.
But I think it's interesting. It'll be Watson Jackson. I think that's the thing to look for. And when they strategically sit the people, I think it'll be Watson next to Jackson towards the end. That's just how it is. So
it'll probably be Jackson, Watson.
They got to split up the offensive guys with Peppers. They have to.
Yeah, that's what I was gonna say. Jackson, Watson, Peppers, and then the Oklahoma guys.
Yeah, and they could talk about their bowl game.
They could talk
whatever.
About how they won the conference and didn't get in, and they could maybe Saquon will be there in the crowd somewhere, and they could all vent together.
I don't know why Saquon and Barkley would be in the crowd at all, but
Yeah, Pennsylvania, New York. He can make the trip.
Yeah, he could, but, like, that's, I mean. All right, let's see. College football rankings. Let's talk about them.
Yes.
So we have Alabama 1, mm-hmm. Clemson 2, Ohio State 3, Washington 4. I got a lot to talk about. Penn State wins their conference. They win the Big Ten. The best conference in football.
In an amazing comeback.
Yeah, they're just a second-half team. That's what they do.
Yeah.
They're a very exciting team to watch. They do not make it. A lot of us saw it coming. I was hoping that they were going to be able to jump. I wanted Washington to stay in, but I also wanted Penn State to be in, and I knew that was a pipe dream. So I was expecting either Penn State being in or Washington being out.
Mm-hmm.
Penn State is out. They're in the Rose Bowl against USC. Ohio State did fall one spot. What I would have rather seen is them fall to 4 and Washington go up to 3. Just because that would be the committee's way of, yes, we do still
value conference
championships, but we also value who we think are the best team and best competition is. And on top of that, if they're trying to get most viewers and the best games on New Year's Eve, which was the problem last year, wouldn't you want that Alabama-Ohio State rivalry to continue and possibly have a 4 upset of 1 in the first round?
Again?
Yeah, exactly. That's how you're going to get the viewers. Why not try and get that as the game? And then you also protect yourself from people saying, oh, well, they didn't play. You just gave them a week off. And put them up against the best team because they're weak. Compared to the other three conference champions that made it, they are the weakest team. And, I mean, just because they don't have a conference championship.
Okay.
And I think that's a way that they could try and be like, you got, like, it's New Year's Eve, but you got to watch this game. Rivalry, they've faced the past 3 college football playoffs. Is that what it's on now, the 3rd?
Yes,
this is
third.
This is going to be a 3rd year in a row that they face each other. Who's going to get it this time? It's 1-1 each team, right?
No, they didn't play last year. I'm just saying it's the 3rd year of the playoff.
Okay. They didn't play last year?
No, Ohio State didn't make it. We beat Notre Dame in the Fiesta Bowl.
Oh, that's right. So, but they faced the first year, and that's kind
yes.
of it's kind of a mini rivalry going on.
Well, I mean, it's Meyer and Saban. That's
yeah,
the whole thing.
I don't know why they didn't try and pitch that because they lost viewers a lot last year. They're trying to get the bowls off of New Year's Eve.
Well, I think the issue was going to be is that there's enough controversy with this because you have 2 conference champions that didn't make it because Ohio State's in. And I think the way it is set up right now, beautiful. You have 2 different styles of team. You know, Alabama likes to hit you in the mouth with the run and the defense. And Washington likes to air it out. That's going to be an interesting game to see, for me at least. But I think what it comes down to is that I think they knew they were going to face criticism for this. Because 1 conference champion is going to be out because you can't fit all 5 power conferences in a 4-team playoff. And if Ohio State's in, then someone else has to be out too, be it the Pac-12 or Big Ten champ, and ended up being the Big Ten. Now, if it was Penn State 3, Ohio State 4, they're fine. Because you want to know something? Washington played in the Pac-12. Sorry, it just wasn't as good of a conference as the Big Ten. But I think with the way it shook out, if you swap Washington and Ohio State, now you're going to have the people that are saying, well, we're Big Ten champs and we beat them. Penn State should be in at 4 instead of Ohio State, who you can make the argument is a better team because of the way that loss went down.
Yeah, but at the same, like, you still get the it's still out there. You still beat the number 3 team in the nation.
Yes, but I think it's worse when if they were right next to each other. And it was, well, therefore we're 5, but we beat them.
I don't think that makes a difference. I think regardless you're not in the playoff and the team you beat is in the playoff and you just missed it.
Oh, I don't disagree. I think they put them at 5 because they're the Big Ten champ.
Yeah.
So they can have the Rose Bowl because I think the way it goes now in a situation like let's say some way Illinois made the Big Ten title game and beat Penn State, then Illinois could still be the Big Ten champ, play the Pinstripe Bowl. Because then at that point, the New Year's Six just becomes the highest ranked Big Ten team to not make the playoff versus the highest ranked Pac-12 team to not make the playoff.
I guess that makes sense why USC made it over Colorado.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, you would think, well, Washington made it, so
why wouldn't you put the runner-up in?
Exactly. Yeah. Probably because their quarterback's hurt now. Yeah. But, I mean, yeah, so I see that. But, I mean, I don't know. I don't think it would make much of a difference from, I mean, you're still going to have the same number of people saying it. I just think it's because, I think you should have done it because Ohio State didn't play that week. So they should be hurt a little. They should face Alabama. Oh, wait, they played in the first playoff and Ohio State was a 4 and upset a 1. Saban Meyer. They faced a lot in the SEC when he was at Florida.
Yeah.
You guys remember those Tebow days? You guys should check this game out. It's prime time, New Year's Eve.
Yeah.
If you're having a party, put it on. You know what I mean? Like.
Well, but I think I'll counter you with, I don't know how much you remember last year because Notre Dame was in it, but, you know, they weren't really contending for the 4.
Yeah.
But when Ohio State lost to Michigan State and then spanked Michigan, everyone was saying, similar to this year, they're better than Oklahoma. Look at their team. I mean, Zeke, Bosa, you know, Cardale, Lee, Apple. Everyone was saying they had a better team than Oklahoma. You know, it was just Oklahoma played in the Big 12, put Ohio State in. And then Oklahoma got destroyed by Clemson. So I think that may be part of it as well. If you think that Ohio State was better than Oklahoma, granted, year removed, play the same team they played and got destroyed by. And I think to counter that, then they could potentially, if Ohio State beats Clemson, they get, I mean, Washington's been fun to watch, but they ain't beating Bama.
Well, I think that's why you would have to put out Ohio State against Alabama, because now you're going to get crap if it's a bad game. People are going to say, oh, well, why didn't Penn State make it? Penn State would have had a better game than that. Penn State would have done this. And, like, it's all just hearsay, but you're going to get that slack. Whereas if you put Ohio State there, Ohio State's going to play a better game just because of Meyer knowing Saban.
Yeah.
And Saban knowing Meyer. It'll just be a better game overall than I think Washington. I hope Washington surprises some people. I like Chris Peterson. This is the first time he's really tasted the playoff ever since getting shafted when he was at Boise State with the BCS. So I just think.
Well, I was talking about with Mike the other day. I was like, I think that played a factor in it too. Because I do. I feel like Penn State, had they not blown that game to Pitt, are absolutely in. But I still think they had a legitimate case. I mean, they got to 5.
Yeah.
I still think they had a legitimate case to make the playoff. I do think Chris Peterson got some sympathy, though, for getting screwed over by the computers for how many years.
Well, I mean, I still wouldn't have taken Ohio. Like, if I was going to put Penn State in, I think Ohio State should have been out. That's the way I think it should have been, because it's tough. It's easier to say, all right, well, we think we picked the best team in the Big East, even though they're not the champions, but we do have 3 conference champions.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that'd be a little bit easier than saying, all right, well, now we have
2 in the same conference.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I think that they one beat the other one, but one still ranked ahead. Like, it would just get too, and there were some people that wanted Michigan in there because they thought they had the best chance against Alabama. I would have put Ohio State against Alabama, and I would have had Clemson-Washington, because I think Clemson-Washington would have been a great game because they play the same type of offense.
Yeah.
And, like, I think you would have, I think, a really hard-fought game between Alabama and Ohio State. Ground and pound. You're going to see 2 young athletic quarterbacks make plays, and you're going to see 2 good defenses. One, Alabama's is great. And then you would have a Clemson-Washington game where they're just airing it out, and they're just a bunch of athletes flying around, making plays, hitting receivers pretty hard. There probably would have been a targeting foul in that game, at least one. And I think seeing those 2 games, they would have been better matchups than what we have. And I think that's where the committee lacks. Like, they may have picked the best 4 teams. They may not have. But at the same time, if you're already going to get crap about putting Ohio State in for Penn State or putting Washington over Penn State, let's pick the best matchup so you don't get that crap. Like Oklahoma, Clemson, Alabama, Michigan State. I mean, Alabama, Michigan State was kind of the same thing. It was like, all right, they're both going to try and beat you with defense, but one's offense is going to be better.
Yeah.
And then it was Oklahoma, Clemson. Clemson's defense played great.
Yeah.
But they were kind of the same.
Poor Bayfield.
They were kind of the same with airing it out. I don't know. And then you saw, the first year it was pretty good games. A lot of people enjoyed getting Florida State getting creamed and Jameis Winston getting creamed.
Yes.
People love the fact that Alabama got upset.
Yeah.
So, and then this last year it really slacked. I hope this year it's kind of like the first year.
Well, I think, not to cut you off, but I think part of the mystery of it is that because they're in the Pac-12 and because they haven't played anybody at a conference, there's kind of a mystery to Washington. How good are they really? You know, can they hang with Alabama? Can they hang with Ohio State and Clemson? And I think that's, for me at least, that's going to get me to tune in to watch. One, because, hell, if Ohio State knocks off Clemson, I'd love to see Washington beat them. Beat Alabama, because I'd much prefer to play Washington. But, you know, looking at it as a fan, and just, I don't know how good Washington is. We know where a team like Ohio State is going to stack up against Alabama because they recruit similar. You know, like you said, they're two very similar styles of team. And the stats just sway in favor of Alabama. Granted, the SEC is weaker, but the numbers sway towards Alabama. They're a better team at doing the same exact thing as Ohio State. If it were Alabama, Penn State, I feel like I would just watch maybe the second half, fourth, you know. Because, and probably I would turn on the second half, and if Alabama was up 35-7, you know, like Wisconsin, I think Wisconsin was up 28-7, I'd turn it off. Alabama's not Wisconsin. And that's just plain and simple. So there's kind of that mystery to the game where it's going to get me to tune in because I don't know how good Washington is.
Yeah,
because they haven't played anybody.
But I think at the same time, it's like if they put Washington up against Clemson,
yeah,
you're going to see a lot less crap being thrown the committee's way.
Yes.
Because Clemson against teams just like Washington, spread offenses that are going to throw the ball and make you try and stop them. They beat Louisville by 6, 42-36. That's a game that'll get some viewers. They beat Florida State 37-34. Game like that will probably get some viewers. They beat Virginia Tech 42-35. I mean, if I'm them, I want to see points and points and points. And then I'll get the rivalry in the other game. And yep. I just think that was the strongest move, could have been the strongest move by them, but as we know, the committee doesn't always make the best choices.
Yeah.
So, we'll see. We'll give our predictions next week. I already kind of know what your prediction is. I feel like you're probably going to take Ohio State all the way, but we'll actually run through all the
Guilty.
Bowl games. All the bowl games should be figured out by next week. So,
yeah.
Maybe we might be able to do that in an hour or a half hour, just be able to pick all the bowl games. Because a lot of the games, it's going to be like, I like Toledo. And then you pick, I don't even know what Toledo's record
yeah.
is, but I know their quarterback has the most touchdowns in all of college football. So just like pick something like that. We can run through them because every year I pick the bowl pools. My whole mom's side, extended family does it. There's like 100 people that end up doing it. So
Notre Dame ended up getting bowl eligible this year?
I don't know if they're going to accept it. I mean, they're not bowl eligible. They're 4-8, but they still might get a bid because they'll bring in the money and like a lot of teams that are 5-7 because there's so many bowls are declining. because especially Texas, they're not going to have a coach.
Yeah.
Or, I mean, they have a coach now, Tom Herman, but he's not obviously going to coach him. So they may end up getting offered because they can bring in viewership, they can bring in money. But I don't know if they will accept it.
And it could be a showcase for Kaiser, too.
Exactly. I don't know if they will accept it, though. So we'll see. I don't know if I'd even want them to accept it because – 4-8, are you kidding me?
Only if they're playing like Akron.
Yeah, really. It's
gonna be like, they can beat.
It's like Jimmy Clausen when they were, I think they were 6-6. They played in the Hawaii Bowl. And Jimmy Clausen threw like 7 touchdowns. It was awesome. It was one of the best Notre Dame games I've watched. And then I realized it was the Hawaii Bowl against Hawaii. And I was like, why am I enjoying this so much? It was on New Year's. Or
win's
Christmas
a win.
Eve. Yeah, exactly. So we'll take our last break here. We'll come back. We'll talk MLB. And that'll wrap us up for the day. We got some moves to talk about. We got some potential moves to talk about. It's going to be a lot of fun. The hot stove's heating up.
Yes.
Keeping us warm here in the studio. Monday Night Lights, 101.7 WDSR.
It's all cold down along the beach. The wind's whipping down the boardwalk. Hey, man! Hey, man! You guys know what time of year it is? What time? Oh, Christmas time. You guys all been good and practicing real hard. Yeah. Clients, you've been rehearsing real hard now. So Santa, bring your new saxophone, right? Everybody out there been good or what? Oh, that's not many. You guys in trouble out here. Yeah, you better watch out. You better not cry. You better not pout. I'm telling you why. Santa Claus is coming to town. Santa Claus is coming to town. Santa Claus is coming to town. He's making a list. He's checking it.
Yeah!
Monday Lights, 101.7 WDSR. That's probably one of the best Christmas songs.
Oh, yeah.
When you get Bruce, like, because, like, I don't know, like, I was listening to Christmas music the other day, and I was, like, all the old songs are kind of like, I'm dreaming.
Yeah.
And kind of just like, I'm like, all right, dude, like, I'm trying to get pumped for Christmas. I'm not trying to fall asleep. But then you put on some Bruce, you put on some Elton John, and then you're like, let's get
Christmas.
Hyped. Let's buy some presents. Let's bake some cookies. Like, let's do this thing. And that's what I want Christmas to feel like. I want to get pumped up for Christmas. I don't want to fall asleep next to a fireplace with some cocoa in my hand.
Yes.
I want to get pumped up for Christmas. But I don't know. Maybe that's just me. Maybe I'm odd. I don't know. I'll have to ask. Maybe we should make a poll about that. Make a poll.
Okay.
So what Christmas music is better? Do you like softer, like older Christmas music, or like an upbeat Christmas music? Maybe put like slower Christmas music and like Prince's like Sinatra, or like upbeat Christmas music and like put like Prince's Springsteen or something like that. We'll see what the fans like. So if you like the slower Christmas songs, make sure you get on Twitter and vote. Hopefully this doesn't end like the hot coffee.
I don't think it will.
Have the poll close on Christmas Day.
I don't think I can go that far.
Oh, man, really? Go as far as you can, then. Can't you leave like a poll open for like ever? I don't know. I don't make polls much. Not really into that. But, yeah, I don't know. I want people to be on my side, or know that I'm not alone in making comments, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, the reason I made the iced coffee hot coffee, other than to try and beat you, was make sure that I wasn't alone. Like, making sure, like, it just didn't pass me by that, like, I got into the hot coffee trend, and then everyone was like, oh, yeah, no, that's... No one likes hot coffee anymore.
Yeah.
Only, like, you and, like, people over 40. And I'd be like, oh, crap, I guess I gotta change my ways. So I'm gonna make sure that I don't have to change my ways now, and... Because I'd rather not listen to... Like, because, I mean... There's some good ones, but overall, like, they can just drag out and be tough. So as Lewis is working on the Twitter poll, the hottest Twitter poll on Twitter currently, or when he posts it, we're going to talk some MLB offseason for about 23 minutes, give or take. Some signings that have happened are Mark Melancon. He went to the Giants. He's only getting paid $4 million this upcoming year because it's a lot of signing bonuses, and then they'll have Matt Cain coming off the books, and then it's like $14, $14, and $18 million dollars each year. I think it's for 4 years. Then you have Steve Pierce, a utility man. He could play first, second, both corner outfield positions. He was with Baltimore. Then he went with Tampa Bay last year, had a pretty good year, got traded back to Baltimore, struggled, hurt himself, and then now will be with Toronto.
It's tweeted.
There it is. So go vote on the Twitter poll, and we'll see if I'm insane or if I just want them to change the type of music. So cool. There's one vote. I'm winning. And apparently I'm beat sloppy this quarter, so that's no fun. But... let's see. What else? What other moves did I miss? Kendrys Morales. That happened a while ago. Cespedes back with the Mets. Possible Bruce or Granderson trade.
Well, I saw today they're hammering out the details of Granderson to Baltimore for Brad Brock.
That wouldn't be a bad deal at all. We'll see if Brad Brock can actually have the same amount of success that he did in Baltimore. It's weird. Baltimore is a very hitter-friendly ballpark, but they're able to get guys who were never good at pitching that pitch good there. Same thing with Pittsburgh.
It looks as though the Mets are going to go with, instead of paying a Chapman or Jansen, letting Reed, who was a closer in Arizona, close for the time being until they get Familia back, and then lengthen the bullpen, obviously, with a Brock or someone else. After Familia gets back and have a 7-8-9.
Not a terrible decision to save money there, because you did put out a lot of money for Cespedes, and you are paying the qualifying offer for
Neil Walker.
And you're still paying David Wright.
Mm-hmm.
So what's the outfield going to look like? It's going to be Conforto, Cespedes.
Supposedly Cespedes, Lagares, and either Bruce or Granderson, whoever stays.
Okay, and then they're going to use Conforto as a fourth outfield and start him in AAA.
Conforto will probably start the year in AAA.
And who is their fourth outfield going to be? Is it maybe
they may sign someone. I'm not sure if Diaz is under contract again for next year.
Gotcha.
But yeah, they've said they'll address that when the time comes. But for now, at least, I mean, it may end up being Conforto just because of, do you really want to keep both him and Nimmo in AAA all year? You know, or they could sign someone. Not too big of a deal. They did get the bat they needed to bring back. So
very true. So if they're able to move Granderson or Bruce, that is actually a big time help for that outfield jam. Because I mean, you got to play Conforto and Nimmo eventually, or get rid of them because they are eventually just going to be washed up prospects. I'm interested that Granderson instead of Bruce is the name coming up for the Orioles, but
yeah,
maybe the Mets want more for Bruce.
See, I don't think it's that the Mets want more. I think it's that Bruce didn't do anything.
True,
after the trade.
But Mark Trumbo didn't do anything for the previous 2 years before he went to Baltimore. And I
think are the Mets gonna wanna, if they're in a situation, okay, if they're in, okay, if come the trade deadline, they're in and they could benefit long term from moving a Bruce call up Conforto. Bruce's contract's up after the year. If they're in a spot where they're in, if they're somehow ahead of Washington and Bruce isn't contributing anyway, you could deal him, get something for him then, and then cut your losses and call up Conforto. I think, yeah, you know, Granderson hit 30 home runs last year, didn't have the RBIs at all. I feel like he had like 30 home runs and 35 RBIs. But obviously Baltimore, you know, likes to get guys on base, and they're going to have to replace Trumbo's homers somehow.
Which is exactly why I thought Bruce would work better, and I thought he would cost less because, I mean, for the Mets, I mean, there's two guys that you're trying to get rid of. You're trying to get rid of at least one. At the end of the year, you'll get rid of the other one. But that is something interesting to look at. I think Baltimore could use either of those guys.
Yeah.
Maybe the Mets may be eating some money, and they'd rather eat money on Grant. I don't know. But either way, I think he'll probably have the best year of their career when they go to Baltimore, because that's how it works.
Yeah, I mean, I think you just got to look at the thing with Granderson, and this is what I think is going to benefit the factor of him potentially getting traded over Bruce, too, is that if it's Baltimore, when he went to the Mets originally, everyone was saying, even if he, you know, doesn't take a step back and whatever, he's a 20 to 25 home run guy playing in Citi Field compared to the 40 in the year as a Yankee. And I think you put him in just as friendly a hitter's ballpark, if not friendlier, in Baltimore. Plus, he still gets to play at Yankee Stadium, still gets to play in Boston. So I think, you know, it may be kind of taking a, you know, Cruz was kind of a Hail Mary. Trumbo was kind of a Hail Mary, and they paid off for the Orioles. Mm-hmm. As opposed to Granderson, who we've seen play well in the AL East and hit 40 home runs and drive in, you know, 90 or 100 runs in the middle of the Yankee order. Mm-hmm. And I think when you have guys like Machado, like Jones, that can kind of hit all over the order, Granderson fits right in with them, as opposed to Bruce, who's really a strict middle of the lineup guy.
True. And I mean, Nelson Cruz, not so much of a Hail Mary. He knew what he could do.
Yeah.
It was just giving up the pick for him, and I didn't even think about the left field or the right field. Is it the right field fence in Yankee Stadium?
Yeah.
Where Granderson made a living.
Yeah.
For a couple of years, I totally slipped my mind. And then you have Pesky Pole. I mean, his power and his ability to move around the lineup, and still a decent fielder, not what he used to be, with like Detroit, obviously.
Yeah.
But I do see that point there. So it could be a good pickup for both teams, because the Mets could add some bullpen, because really they have no one else to move in the lineup.
Yeah.
I mean, it's kind of stuck where it is, and you just got to hope that it has a good year. Some other moves: Phillies sign Joaquin Benoit to 1 year. The dude's 40, has usually a 2 ERA. I don't think he's been above 3 in about 5 years. Let's see. Last year, 281, 234, 1-1, 2012 was the last time he had an ERA above 3. Last year with Seattle, he started off, he didn't have a very good ERA, but he finished with Toronto with a .38 ERA, so that helped even it out. It's a good signing, and it gives him the opportunity to be able to move a guy like Neris or Genmar Gomez if they are blown away by a deal like the Astros do it for Ken Giles last year. So I do like it because bullpen arms are kind of just, I mean, they're interchangeable.
Yeah.
I mean, there's very rarely you get a big-time reliever that's able to continue success for an entire career out of a setup position. Usually closers are going to be able to do that, or setup men that become closers. I'm trying to think if there's even an example of a reliever that sustained great success that wasn't a closer or never closed in his entire lifetime for that many years. So I like the strategy. I mean, if you do, I mean, you don't have to. It gives, now it'll take off some pressure with Nashek and Benoit. They're older guys.
Oh, you guys got Nashek?
Yeah, got him when he was designated, or they weren't going to pick up his option, Houston, and they were like, we'll trade him, or we're not going to pick up his option. And then I think the Phils gave up cash for him. So,
and just picked up his option.
I mean, $6 million, $7 million, two older bullpen guys that have been around. They've done it. I think they'll only help.
And both in the one-year deals?
Yes.
So totally could be you're going to bide your time until July and then go to a contender.
Exactly. Could be moved, and I think they'll only help guys like Neris and Ramos. Genmar is a little up there, but I think they could help. They could help easily. He was tendered a contract for like $4 million. But, I mean, with such young pitchers on the roster – you got a guy like Hellickson, but, I mean, no matter if they're relievers or starters, I think regardless they help any guy because the pitchers are hanging out all the time.
Yeah.
I don't know if you've heard about that new show called Pitch with the woman pitcher for San Diego. That one thing I was reading about it, they said that we had to change the one thing about baseball in the show because pitchers and position players don't really hang out together.
Oh, yeah, that was in the article for
Oh, yeah. That's
for
right,
intro,
that's right.
Yeah.
That's right. We had to read it for class. So I think it's funny that they changed it for the show. But basically, if you're going to get any type of if you're going to get an older pitcher, it doesn't matter if he's a reliever, starter, because they're all going to be together and they're all going to be communicating. So I think regardless, it helps. McCutchen, there's talk of him possibly going to the Nationals.
Talk of Sale, too.
We did talk McCutchen last week, so I want to talk about Chris Sale this week for about the last 13 minutes. There's a couple teams that were in on him, the Nationals, the Braves, and the Astros are three teams that are really on him. However, Nationals don't want to move Trey Turner.
Yep.
Houston doesn't want to move Bregman, and the Braves don't want to move Swanson.
Mm-hmm.
Do any of those teams get Sale without moving one of those three players?
I think Atlanta does because of Malik Smith.
Well, would they have to go Malik Smith and then plus
I think he's just as elite of a prospect as Swanson.
Yeah, but at the same time, Malik Smith doesn't have the upside as Swanson. And they have the second base prospect, what's his name, Ozzie Albiers?
Yeah, I think so.
And would you need both of them plus another prospect? Because a guy like Bregman, Swanson, or Trey Turner may be equal to three non-major league ready prospects.
Yeah.
So, but you think the Braves, without giving up their star, can still pull off?
I think the Braves can still pull it off. I think the Nationals could if they don't also land McCutchen. I think McCutchen would absolutely cost you Giolito. Just because I think if they're moving McCutchen, I think that's the direction they're heading towards. Is similar to the Giants of, 6 years ago where they had all those pitchers, and now you see with the Mets and their pitching. I think if you're moving McCutchen, it's clear that you're going to move on with Gerrit Cole being the face of your franchise, and then, Jameson Taillon, who's the other pitcher they have?
Glasnow.
Glasnow. And obviously Giolito would just, take that to the next level and say, well, now we have four aces, and then who knows if they have another guy come up. I don't really know their farm system too well. you know, I think that's clear if they move on from McCutchen, that that's the direction we're going with, is we're going to go pitching first, because that team is, granted, the other players are good. You know, Marte, Polanco, Kang, Cervelli. But that team, when you look at it, is Andrew McCutchen and Gerrit Cole. And if you move one of them, the other one's the face of your franchise for the next 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 years. So I would think it would be Giolito coming back in a potential Nationals deal, which is why if they don't land McCutchen, then I can see it, because, okay, we just build a deal for sale around Giolito. We're upgrading right now, which is where we're trying to win. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Or do they try and get either, because the Pirates will want Turner.
Yes.
The White Sox will want Turner.
Yeah.
Do they try and get one of the guys without Turner and get the other guy with Turner?
I mean, if they were to land both of them, yes, Trey Turner would have to go to someone and Giolito would go to the other. I don't think there's any way you're landing both of them without giving up both Giolito and Turner.
An article came out today explaining how the Nationals were surprised at the numbers Harper wanted. And
how?
Harper wants 10 or more years, $400 or more million.
Yeah.
Dollars. I mean, me and you both know that. And I was looking at a lot of writers, and they were like, how do you not know that this
that he
player
wants that much money?
At only, like, he's only, what, 24? 20,
yeah, 25, 4, 25.
And he's has great numbers. Last year, down year. But that was his first down years in the majors,
mm-hmm,
ever. Do they say, all right, well, maybe it's going to take, maybe we can get both these stars, but maybe we have to move on from a guy like Harper now, and maybe our team can take off without Harper. We don't have to pay him. We got two stars on two very, very team-friendly deals. Could that be a thought?
My problem with that is that,
because if they do that, they probably can keep Turner.
Yes. The problem is that, you know, Andrew McCutchen being traded is abstract. A player of that caliber doesn't, mm-hmm, get moved every day. And now you're going to take it to the next level with Harper. You're talking either both superstars in their own right, but a lesser superstar in McCutchen. Granted, that could be because he was playing in Pittsburgh, didn't have the media coverage, whatever. But from what we know, lesser superstar than Bryce Harper. The question's going to be, and obviously I wouldn't do this with Chris Sale, just because he's a pitcher, he goes every fifth day, and if he blows out his arm, then he just lost Bryce Harper.
Mm-hmm.
But I think when you look at McCutchen, if they were to move Harper, I would say it almost goes from, you know, if you had to pick a buyer and seller in the deal, it almost immediately goes from Washington being the buyer and getting the superstar caliber player in McCutchen to Pittsburgh being the buyer because you're getting the better player.
Yeah, but granted, if they, whatever team Harper goes to, it's not going to be I don't think it would be a straight-up swap. I think,
yeah,
either Chicago or Pittsburgh would have to throw in another, like, a prospect.
Exactly. And the problem that I have with that is that if Washington, who is shocked by his value, and granted, Washington hasn't gone on any major spending sprees like we've seen some teams do. I mean, they have had some big contracts, Worth, Scherzer, and now re-signing Strasburg. You know, and obviously, you know, a few years back, they had interest in Prince Fielder when he was leaving Milwaukee, and they had interest in Pujols that year, and they've had interest in guys that have been big money guys. The question's going to be is that if you're looking at sending Bryce Harper for Andrew McCutchen, Pittsburgh would have to give back more. Chicago would have to give back more.
Mm-hmm.
Chicago would have to give back significantly more than Pittsburgh, because their guy only goes every fifth day as opposed to McCutchen, who plays every day. when he's healthy. Chicago, I think, would have to add way too much, and they don't have the farm system to do it.
What if they added like an Adam Eaton? Then I think that's a deal. If you go Bryce Harper for Chris Sale, Adam Eaton, who I think is one of the most underrated players.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I could see that.
What better way for the White Sox to actually be talked about
than to get Harper?
Than to get Bryce Harper. Make a splash like that. Because they have great pitching prospects. You have Quintana. You have Rondon. Fulmer. You have Fulmer. I mean, and then you can go out and get like a Doug Fister. Who cares? Like, fill up the staff. If you're able to put a guy like Harper in a lineup with Abreu and Frazier.
The problem is that any team would have to think they have the financial resources to keep him. If you're going to give up that much.
Chicago has never been against spending. I mean, look at what look at what they've done to try and become good.
Yeah.
Look at some of the guys that they've signed. I mean, Melky Cabrera is eventually going to be coming off the books. I mean, Lowry, I don't even think maybe he'll play the rest of this year. But, I mean, he was a non-tender candidate up until this. Abreu's on a great team-friendly deal.
Yeah.
You're paying Frazier. You're getting the money off of Sale off the books. Eventually, Robertson's going to be off the books.
Uh-huh.
I mean, I know it's crazy and it probably won't happen. But this is what makes the offseason so great.
Yeah, that's the other problem I have with it, is that I feel like these deals are being done to try to win with him. Try to win with Bryce Harper. And, I mean, whew, crap. If you put a rotation together of Chris Sale, Max Scherzer, and Strasburg, and have McCutcheon and Harper and Worth in the outfield, you know, with Rendon and Turner at short and Murphy and Zimmerman and, you know, Derek Norris they just got, home run guy. The Mets can do all they want. They could sign the top free agent for the next 3 years. It ain't happening. So that's the other issue I have, is that they're trying to win with him to keep him there and say, well, we, you know, look at this core we have. If you, you know, obviously it puts them in the situation where they have to sign then him and McCutcheon in the same year. But you want to know something? If you win two World Series between now and then, you can do that.
Mm-hmm.
Especially because Sale will still be on his team-friendly deal. You know, Scherzer will be in going into year five, so he'll only have 3 years left on his deal. Granted, they have to pay him for seven more after that, but, you know, they could do it, you know, and if they win one, I think it keeps. If they win two, it definitely keeps him. You know, and I think that's the thing, is they're trying to win with him and keep him there, similar to what we saw in 2009 when Cleveland tried everything they could to try to win a finals with LeBron, and they didn't, and he left.
Yeah. I mean, I'm just saying, like, you saw Bryce Harper can be a hothead. He can be a showboat. Maybe it's just doesn't – maybe it's not working. Maybe, like, it's just not rubbing the rest of the team the right way. I mean, it could fire up someone here and there, but at the same time, you're like, all right, dude, like, is that too much?
Yeah.
Well,
I saw a thing today.
And then maybe – sorry if I
– No.
And then if you were able to supplement him – for two all-stars that took team-friendly deals and are, like just all about the team. Not saying Bryce Harper isn't, but they're not outspoken. They're just going to do their thing. They're going to play.
Unless you have a jersey with a collar on it.
Yeah, I mean, they're just kind of, like, Dusty Baker guys. Like, think about the guys Dusty Baker won with. Like, they weren't, like, the most polarizing superstars. They were just really, really good players that did their thing every day. And I think if you, like, I think you could do it. You could keep Turner. And, I mean, obviously, like we said, not going to happen. But, man, that would be something.
Interesting discussion of the last couple minutes, you know, last minute or so here. I saw an article, not really an article. It was a page, and it had 29 polls. And it was each team, you know, from, you know, the Yankees to the Twins. Would you want Bryce Harper on your team? There was only one team where the fans voted no. the Mets. And I thought, I was like, why? Like, you know, we just signed Cespedes for 4 years. I'd love to have him and Bryce Harper in the same outfield. And then I was reading the comments, and one guy made a really good point. Bryce Harper got mad because fans left the game early and then booed him after one strikeout because he made a comment the day before about fans leaving. He can't handle New York. I really don't think he could handle New York. Which, with that said, Yankees, please spend on him. Please spend $40 million a year to get him in pinstripes, because I'd love to see him flop.
I mean, I don't know if he would flop, but, I mean, he could be an issue, and you saw the fight with Papon. Whoever started it, you look for more from your superstar. I just thought it would be an interesting topic to talk about, because that's the best time to talk about trades like this, when they actually kind of sort of can happen, because it is the winter meetings. When you get a lot of GMs in the same hotel playing a lot of golf, probably drinking like scotch on the rocks or whatever. They're smoking some cigars. Anything could happen. I believe there is an old story about one night a guy from the Red Sox, I believe the GM, and the GM from the Yankees, I don't know, or maybe they were the owners, I forget their names. They were drinking scotch one night and hanging out, and they discussed swapping Ted Williams for Joe DiMaggio. It didn't happen, obviously.
Didn't happen, but
they thought about it, and hey, man, when you get GMs in the same building for, like, I think it's the full week, a lot of things can happen. So
that's they said on MLB Network, I think the day before the winter meeting started, and he said that they were all doing like one bold trade or one bold move that we're not expecting heading into the winter meetings. And the guy goes, Mike Trout for Bryce Harper, straight up.
Oh, I think was that Richard Justice that said
it,
that?
It might have been, yeah. But he goes, yeah, straight up. And he said a similar thing. He goes, these GMs get together, they talk, and then this kind of stuff comes up. I'm sure it'll be a rumor at some point. And then he said, he was like, it would make sense, you know? Mike Trout's under contract for a couple more years after Harper, you know. Maybe he likes Washington, can get Mike Trout there and then get Harper back in 2 years. You never know.
Yeah, but I think Trout overall is a better player if you look at the stats. But, I mean, that would be that would be something. And that's what makes the winter meetings and baseball, because there's way more player movement involved. There's way more big splashes involved, and that's why you gotta love baseball. Yep. That's why it's my favorite sport, and that's why I want to cover it. So, I think that'll wrap us up for this week. I'm searching for a song to play because I don't know what's on this computer. I play my own songs, but I don't upload them to the computer. And there's a lot of weird. Some Meatloaf. I'll play some Meatloaf. So thank you for joining us this week on Monday Night Lights. It was a blast. If you're bored and you want to read something, check out Lewis's articles on Page 2 Sports. He's recapping every division, what they should do for the offseason, if you enjoyed our baseball talk. And then we'll be back here next week, and that'll be our last show until
next semester.
Next semester. So we'll probably put out some podcasts over Christmas break, but not weekly. We'll do as we feel, as the holidays permits, because I know there's a lot of parties going on. I was just invited on Facebook to my family's Pollyanna party, so my family's officially gone the Facebook route. Thank you for joining us once again. Had a lot of fun on Monday Night Lights 101.7 WDSR. See you next week.